to get started, but before we do, I just wanted to let you know that at intermission, we have a bake sale out in the backyard area over here to the side yard, and it's by donation, and all the proceeds are gonna go to Innovative Performers of Chico for equipment and sound things and prop money for future productions. So look forward to that. If you have any questions, you can find one of us moms. Otherwise, enjoy the show. And this is their first performance in a big venue like this. These are homeschooled kiddos. And they're really excited to do this performance. If you have family or friends that didn't get to come tonight, they are having a second performance on Wednesday. So you can find one of the cast members or a family member, and we can get you connected with the tickets. All right, thank you and enjoy the show.
Long ago, when your great-great-grandfather was a child. It is a very important story because it shows how all the comings and goings between our own world and the land of Narnia first began. In those days, Mr. Sherlock Holmes was still living in Baker Street, and if you were a boy, you had to wear a stiff-collared shirt every day, and schools were far stricter and harsher than they are now. But meals were nicer, and as for sweets, I won't tell you how cheap and good they were. Only make your mouth water. And in those days, there lived in London a girl called Polly Plummer.
Oh, hello.
Hello, what's your name?
Polly Plummer, what's yours?
Diggory.
I say, what a funny name.
It's not half as funny as Polly.
Yes, it is.
No, it isn't.
At any rate, at least I wash my face, like you need to, since you've been...
All right, so I have been crying. And you would be too, if you lived all your life in the country, and had a pony, and a river at the bottom of the garden, and all this hadn't been brought to live in a beastly hole like this.
London isn't a hole, it's...
And if your father was away in India, and you had to live with an aunt, and an uncle who's mad, how would you like that? And if the reason was that they were looking after your mother, and your mother was ill and was going to die?
I didn't know. I'm so very sorry. Until you peeked over the wall, I didn't know anyone lived with Mr. Ketterly and Mrs. Ketterly. I thought they were... What I mean to say is...
You thought they were an old bachelor and an old maid. That's because they are. It's an old house with old things, and nobody younger than they should have to live in it.
Is your uncle really mad?
Either he's mad, or there's some other mystery. He has a study on the top floor and says I must never go into it. That in itself is fishy. Grown-ups always have places they won't let children into. And there's another thing. Whenever he tries to speak to me at mealtimes, Aunt Lady won't let him. She says, "Don't worry the boy, Andrew," or, "Diggory, wouldn't you like to go outside and play in the garden?"
What sort of things does he try to say to you?
That's it. I don't know. He never gets far enough. And there's more than that. Last night, as I was going past the foot of the stairs, I heard a yell.
Honestly, perhaps he keeps a mad wife up there.
I thought of that. Or he may be a pirate, hiding from his old shipmates.
How exciting. I never knew your house was so interesting.
You may think it's interesting, but you wouldn't like it if you had to live there.
Say, Diggory, how would you like to visit my house sometime? All my friends are away on holiday for the summer, and it's been so dreary.
So that's how Polly and Diggory got to know one another, and it was just the beginning of the summer holidays, and they met nearly every day. It was one of the wettest and coldest summers there had been for years. That called for, that drove them to do indoor things, or as you might say, indoor exploration. It's wonderful how much exploring you can do with a candle in a big house, or better yet, a row of houses. Polly had discovered long ago that if you opened a certain little door in the attic of her house, you would find a place that was like a long tunnel with rafters. And Polly had turned the place into a smuggler's cave with candles and bottles and treasures. They spent days in that attic. And through all this is how the real story begins.
Good cave, Polly. Say, how long does this tunnel go on for? I mean, does it stop where your house ends?
No, the walls don't go out to the roof. It goes on. I don't know how far. I suppose we could go the length of the whole row of houses. Oh, so we could get into other houses, couldn't we?
Yes, and get taken for burglars. No thanks.
Don't be so jolly clever. I was thinking of the house beyond yours. It's the empty one. Papa says it's been that way since we moved here. I think it might be haunted.
Well, I suppose we ought to have a look at it then. What if it is Oh, never mind. Shall we go and see now?
All right.
Don't, if you'd rather not.
I'm game if you are.
I expect it's not actually empty. We'll probably find a gang of criminals and get a reward. It's all rot to say a house would be empty all these years if there wasn't some mystery.
Daddy thought it must be the pipes.
Prosh, grown-ups are always thinking of uninteresting explanations.
Well, come along.
Shall I?
I'm game if you are. It's all right. There's no one here.
This is no good. It's no empty house after all. We'd better scat before someone comes.
What do you suppose these are?
Oh, come on. The sooner we leave, the sooner we'll be...
Oh, my boy.
Uncle Andrew!
I'm delighted to see you. Now my sister can't interrupt us.
Please, Mr. Ketterly, I've got to get home. I left a
rutabaga in the oven.
Yes, so please let us out.
Not just yet. This is too good an opportunity to miss. I wanted two children. You see, I'm in the middle of a great experiment. I tried it on a guinea pig, and it seemed to work, but a guinea pig can't tell you anything. And you can't explain to it how to come back.
Look here, Uncle Andrew. It really is dinner time, and they'll be looking for us in a moment. You must let us out.
If you let us go for a dinner now, we could come back afterwards.
Oh, well, yes, if you really want to go. I can't expect two youngsters like you to find it much fun talking to an old duffer like me. You have no idea how lonely I sometimes am, but no matter. Go on. Oh, but wait. I must give you a present before you go. It's not every day I see a girl in my dingy old study, especially, if I may say so, a very lovely young lady as yourself. Wouldn't you like one of those rings, my dear?
Do you mean one of those yellow or green ones? How lovely.
Not a green one, not presently, but I'd be delighted to give you any of the yellow ones. Come, let me place one on your finger.
Why? The humming noise gets louder here. It's almost as if the rings were making it.
What a funny fancy, my dear.
Polly, don't be a fool! Don't touch them!
Ah! None of that. If you make a noise, your mother will hear, and you know what a fright might do to her. That's better. Perhaps you couldn't help it. It is a shock when you first see it vanishing. You even gave me a scare when the guinea pig disappeared a couple weeks ago.
What happened to Polly?
Congratulate me, my dear boy. My experiment has succeeded. The little girl's gone, vanished right out of the world.
What have you done with her?
Sent her to another place. I shall explain. My godmother, Miss Leffe, it's a photo from the mantle, became rather odd late in her life, did very unwise things. That's where they shut her up.
In an asylum, you mean?
Oh, no, nothing of that sort. Only a prison.
I say, what has she done?
Ah, poor woman, she was a magical genius, but other people, common people, they don't understand such things. She even taught me some magic, made me swear that I would never try to travel to other worlds. So, of course, the first thing I did when she passed was to try to do just that.
Well then, it was jolly rotten of you!
Rotten? True and proper it is to keep your promises, but although that's well and good for little boys and servants and women and people in general of common minds and callings, it is not necessarily good for a wise, sage magician like myself. Anyways, I found a box with some plain rings and some instructions. I followed the instructions, and the plain rings turned into the vibrant, glowing rings they are now. I experimented to see what it did with the guinea pig. Some of them only died.
It was a cruel thing to do!
If you'll let me continue, I discovered that the yellow rings would take any creature that touched them into the other place, and the green one would bring them back. Although I'm not entirely sure it works, that's why I wanted you and the girl to go. You could discover if it works.
Why don't you go yourself then?
You must be mad. Just the shock and danger of being flung into a different universe. I've never heard of anything so preposterous in my life.
But you sent Polly into it. All I can say is, even if you are my uncle, you're a coward. Sending a girl to a place you won't go to yourself.
Silence, sir. I'll not be talked like that by a little dirty schoolboy. Can't you see? I'm the great magician, the scholar, the adept who is doing the experiment. Bless my soul. Next to me, telling me you ought to have asked the guinea pig's permission before I used them.
Oh, do stop jawing. Are you going to bring Polly back?
Oh, how you do harp about the girl as if that was what mattered. I was going to tell you, but you keep interrupting. She simply needs to put on a green ring.
But Polly hasn't got a green ring.
No, she hasn't.
Well, then she can't get back. And it's exactly the same as if you'd murdered her.
She can get back. If someone will go after her wearing yellow ring and taking two green rings. Oh, I hope, Degree, that you won't be a coward considering your lecture to me on this subject. I should be very sorry to think that anyone in our family had not enough honor or chivalry to go to the aid of a lady in distress.
Oh, do shut up. If you had any honor and all that, you'd be going yourself. But I see I've got to go, and you are a beast. You'll pay for this in the end. Your sort always do.
I think it would be wiser for you to worry about your friend than about my sort. If there are any dangers in the other world, it'd be a pity to arrive a moment too late.
A lot you care. Anyways, I'm sick of this talk. What have I got to do?
The rings only work if they're actually touching your skin. The moment you touch a yellow ring, you'll vanish out of this world. When you're in the other place, I suspect, when you touch a green ring, you'll vanish out of that world and reappear in this. Now the sooner you go, the sooner I'll be back.
Not that you know if I can get back or not.
Very well, then. Go down and have your dinner. And leave your little friend to be eaten by wild animals, or drown, or starve in the other world, or left there for good if you wish. Perhaps you'll have time to drop in on Miss Plummer and explain why she'll never see her daughter again because you were too afraid to put on a ring.
By gum! Don't I wish I was big enough to punch your head!
Diggory touched the ring, and he thought then, as he always thought afterwards, too, that he couldn't decently have done anything else. Uncle Andrew and his study vanished instantly, and for a moment, everything became muddled. Next thing Diggory knew was there was a soft green light coming on him from above, and darkness below. He didn't seem to be sitting or standing on anything. Nothing seemed to be touching him. He thought he was in water, or worse, underwater. This frightened him for a second, but almost at once he could feel that he was rushing upward. Then his head suddenly came up and out into the air, and he found himself ashore up on a grassy ground at the edge of a pool. Strangely, as he rose to his feet, he noticed he was neither dripping nor panting for breath, as anyone would expect after being underwater. His clothes were perfectly dry. There were pools here and there, and trees, and a strange stillness about the world. It was, as Diggory would describe later, a rich place. Surprisingly, Diggory was not frightened. In fact, he'd half forgotten why he had come there or what he was supposed to do. He felt as if he had always been there.
I think I've seen you before.
I rather think so, too. Have you been here long?
Oh, always. At least, I don't know. A very long time.
So have I.
No, you haven't. I've just seen you come up out of that pool.
Why, yes. I guess I did. I'd forgotten.
Look here. I wonder if we've indeed met before. I have sort of a picture in my mind of a boy and a girl quite like us, living somewhere far away and doing all sorts of things. Perhaps it was only a dream.
I've had the same dream, I think, of a boy and a girl living next door and... Say, what's that on your finger? Uncle Andrew! Oh, how beastly he is.
So what do we do now? Go home?
There's no hurry.
Stop it, Diggory. I think it's so dreamy here that if we were to stay here any longer, we'd just lie down and drowse forever. But we've got to get home. Oh, but how?
Go back into the pool, I expect. One, two, three, go. Oh, the rings. Here, let's put on the green ones. Only let's try a different pool. I suppose there are different worlds in others.
You mean this place may be a wood between worlds?
Yes, exactly. That's why it's so odd here. Nothing ever happens in this world. So which pool shall we try?
I don't think we should.
Come, let us have some fun. Let's try this one. We'll slip the rings on our fingers on the count of three.
I'm game if you are.
One, two, three, go. Here, we must have a look around. There's not much point in magic rings that let you into other worlds if you're too afraid to look at the world once you're in them.
Who's talking about being afraid? I'll go where you go.
Let's go up these stairs. Polly, look.
Are they dead?
More like frozen in time.
But how?
Magic. Can't you feel it? I bet this whole room is just stiff with enchantments. Look at their faces, Polly. They were nice people, I think.
They seem nice enough, except this group.
Oh, yes. You'd have to mind yourself with them.
And look at these people.
Cruel, I'd say.
Doesn't it strike you as odd? Those down there look nice. Then up here, they look unhappy and then cruel. And these look as if they're in despair, as if they'd done dreadful things and suffered dreadful things.
Oh, look at her.
She's so pale.
And beautiful.
Do you think so? I don't.
She must have been the queen, or someone who is very important. You can tell just to look at her. Oh, I do wish we knew the story behind all this. Let's go back and look at this sort of table in the middle of the room.
There seems to be something written here.
So there is. Make your choice, adventurous stranger. Strike the bell and bide the danger. Or wonder, till it drives you mad, what would have followed if you had?
No fear, we don't want any danger.
But don't you see? We can't get out of it now. We'll always be wondering what would happen if we had struck the bell. I'm not going to be driven mad by always thinking of that. No fear.
Don't be so silly. What does it matter what would have happened?
I expect anyone who's come this far as ought to go on wondering till it sends him dotty. That's the magic of it. Don't you see? I can begin to feel it working on me already.
Well, I don't, and I don't believe you do either. You're just putting it on.
Well, you'd say that. That's because you're a girl. Girls never want to know anything but gossip and rot about people getting engaged and such.
You looked exactly like your uncle when you said that. How exactly like a man. And don't say I'm like a woman, or you'll be a beastly copycat.
I should never dream of calling a kid like you a woman.
Oh, I'm a kid, am I? Well, you needn't be bothered by having a kid with you anymore. I'm off. I've had enough of this place. And you too, you beastly, stuck-up, obstinate pig.
It's all over. Are you all right?
Yes, no thanks to you. I hope you're satisfied now.
Well, it's all over anyways.
Who has awakened me? Jadis, queen of this world, who has broken the spell?
I think it must have been me.
You? But you are only a child, a common child. Anyone can see at a glance that there's not a drop of royal or noble blood in your veins. How does such as you dare to enter this place?
We've come from another world, by magic.
But you are no magician. The mark of it is not on you. You must be the servant of a magician. It is on another's magic that you've traveled here.
Yes, my Uncle Andrew.
There is great peril here. The whole palace is breaking up. If we are not out of it in a few minutes, we shall be buried under the ruins. Look well on that which no eye shall ever see again. That door leads to the dungeons. That passage leads to the principal torture chambers. That was the old banqueting hall, where my great-grandfather bade several hundred nobles to a feast, then killed them all before they had drank their fill. They had rebellious thoughts. Such was Tarn, a great city, the wonder of the world, perhaps of all the worlds. Silent now, but once, full of noises. I have stood here when the roar of battle went up from every street. And then, all in one moment, I bought into doubt. There had been a promise that neither side of the battle would use magic or say the deplorable word. But I did say the word, and then I was the only living thing beneath the sun.
But the people!
Yes, the ordinary people who had never done you any harm, the women and the children and the innocent.
Don't you understand? I was the queen. They were my people. What else were they here for but to do my will?
Rather hard luck on them all the same. Was it the deplorable word that made the sun like that? All red and so cold? Our sun is nothing like that.
Ah, so yours is a younger world. Let us be going. It is cold here at the end of all ages.
Going?
To your world, of course.
Oh, I didn't know you wanted to go there. I'm sure you wouldn't like our world at all. Very dull. Not worth seeing, really.
It will be worth seeing when I rule it.
But you can't. It's not like that, you know. I don't think President McKinley or King Edward would like that.
Don't you think that I, with my beauty and my magic, would have your whole world at my feet before a year has passed? Prepare your incantations and take me there at once. Your uncle is expecting me, I suppose. He must be a very great magician if he has found how to send you here. Is he king of your whole world or only of part?
He isn't the king of anywhere.
You are lying. Whoever heard of common people being magicians? Your uncle must be a mighty keen enchanter, and to see my face in a magic mirror such, and has made a spell to send for me. Is that not how it was?
Well, not exactly.
Not exactly. Why, it's absolute rubbish from beginning to end.
Silence, fool! I'll the truth out of you yet.
Quick, Polly, now!
They plunged their hands into their pockets. They didn't even need to put the rings on their fingers. The moment they touched them, the dreary world vanished from their eyes. They were rushing upward, and a warm green light was growing nearer overhead. There was something that Uncle Andrew and Polly and Diggory didn't know about the rings. In order to jump from world to world, you don't need to be touching or wearing it by yourself. It's enough if you're touching someone who is touching it. So it was when Diggory and Polly came out of the pool into the quietness of the wood between the worlds. Things were not so quiet.
For her at once.
Quick, Diggory, change rings and into the home pool.
Right.
Take me with you. Don't leave me in this horrible place.
Quick, Polly, she's chasing us.
Put on the green rings. Hurry, where is the home pool?
There, do you see my marking?
You dare leave me?
She's here. Jump, Polly, jump.
Oh dear, oh dear, what now?
Where is the magician who has called me into this world?
Madam, I'm most honored, highly gratified, most unexpected pleasure.
Where is the magician, fool?
I am he.
You! Let me see your face! Oh, I see. You are a magician, of a sort. Stand up, dog, and don't behave as if you were speaking to your equal. How do you come to know magic? You are not of royal blood.
Perhaps not in the strict sense, not royal blood, but the Kettleys are, however, a very old...
Peace! There is no magic in your heart. Your kind was made an end of in my world 1,000 years ago. But here, I shall allow you to be my servant.
I should be happy, delighted to be of any service and pleasure, I assure you.
You talk far too much. Listen to your first task. Procure for me at once a chariot, or a flying carpet, or a well-trained dragon, or as ever as usual for royal and noble persons in your land. Then take me to places where I can get clothes and jewels and slaves fit for my rank. Tomorrow, I shall begin the conquest of the world.
I'll go fetch a cab at once.
Cab?
A chariot of sorts.
Go!
What are you going to do with us?
It is inconsequential to me what you do. What is that old fool doing? I should run a whip. Fool! Fool, where are you?
Oh, this is simply ghastly having her here. We must make some sort of plan.
That's up to your uncle now. It's he who started this mess with magic. I'm going home.
But you will come back, won't you? Hang it all, you can't leave me in a strait like this.
I shall go home by the tunnel. It'll be the quickest way.
Polly!
If you want me to come back, hadn't you better say you're sorry?
Sorry? Well, now, if that isn't just like a girl, what have I done?
Oh, nothing, of course. Only nearly twisted my wrists off in that room like a cowardly bully. Or only struck the bell like a silly idiot. Or only turned back in the woods so she had time to catch hold of you before we got into the pool. That's all.
Oh, all right. I'll say I'm sorry. I'm sorry. There. Now you please be decent and come back. We shall be in a frightful way if you don't.
I don't see what's going to happen to you. It's your uncle who will be in a mess.
Well, it's not exactly my uncle I'm worried about. It's my mother. What if the queen goes into her room? She might frighten her to death.
I see. All right then, I'll come back if I can, but I must go.
Polly? Thank you.
This tunnel, it seemed like such a grand adventure a few hours ago. Now I wish we had played a game at home instead.
See you later. Oh, I do wish we could get this mess sorted out. And where's Uncle Andrew?
Ah, Letitia, my dear, you're here. Upon my word, I am dreadfully shaken, most upsetting, and at my time of life.
What's happened to you? Did I hear you send Matilda out for a cab?
A cab, well, yes, a nice one at that. She's a superb creature, and I'm a rather well-preserved fellow myself, if I may say so.
Creature, occasion, just what are you on about?
It's rather hard to explain right now, but do be a good girl and lend me 50 pounds or so. I have to go out.
I most certainly will not. How many times have I
told
you?
My dear girl, don't be troublesome. You put me in a very awkward position if you don't. There is someone important I must entertain.
And who, pray, are you going to entertain?
Now, slave, how long might wait for my chariot?
Good heavens, who is this young person, Andrew, may I ask?
A distinguished foreigner, a very important person, you see.
Rubbish. She looks like a shameless hussy. Young lady, you're to leave my house this moment or I'll send for the police.
What woman is this? Down on your knees before I blast you!
No strong language in this house, if you please, young lady!
Legus! What has happened to my powers?
I thought as much. The woman is drunk. Drunk!
Get in the case, sir. The cab has come.
Then lead on, slave.
Andrew!
No time now, Letitia.
I've never seen a vulgar thing in my life. You see that woman, Matilda?
Yes, ma'am. Quite extraordinary.
She must escape from a circus somewhere. And drunk as well. Andrew will come to no good, I know it.
Uncle Andrew? Uncle Andrew? Oh, hello, Aunt Letty. Is Uncle Andrew here?
He just left with that woman.
Oh, no!
What do you know of it?
Only, I think I know how to take her away from here.
Take her away?
Yes. You see, if I can touch her and then slip on my yellow ring, we should both go into the wood between worlds. She seems harmless enough there. Then our world would be safe. It's the only way.
Has everyone lost their minds today?
The poor boy's gone mad.
Which way did they go?
They took a cab. You'll not fall, young man. I haven't seen you for hours, and when did you speak nothing but nonsense? I won't have you rushing out the street in this state of mind. It's been enough that your uncle's put off that creature, and now, not another word. I want you to take me up to your mother. Surely she would like to see you. but you mustn't say anything upset her, poor dear. What have you made for her, Matilda?
What the doctor said to give her, you know. And Miss Phyllis from next door brought her some grapes.
How thoughtful. I'm afraid she used fruit from the land of youth to help her now. Nothing in this world seems to be helping. Don't dawdle, Diggory. Go on, see you to your mother.
Yes, Aunt Letty. You some food.
Please set it at the end of the bed.
You're not going to eat it?
Not at this moment. I'm very tired. What's happening downstairs? I thought I heard a commotion, or was it just a dream?
It feels like a dream. Mother, have you ever heard of the Land of Youth? Aunt Letty said something about it.
Was she telling you a story?
No, she just mentioned it.
Well, it's one of those phrases adults use sometimes. I'm very tired.
Yes, but what if adults use that phrase because there really is a land of youth somewhere, but they'd forgotten where, and it had fruit with special powers? And what if there were magic rings that could take you there? A yellow ring, for example, that a boy might have in his pocket, and he could touch it and go to the land of youth, and all would be well again, and you would be well. Mother, sleep well. Hello, what's that huge ruckus? Great Scott! It's her!
Let go of those shoes!
Oh, they're mine!
Stop in the name of the law!
Mel! Come on, Mel! God, you shall be dealing with
this! I'm going to go!
Come on!
Quick, inside, Diggory.
No, you don't. You're staying right here.
You don't understand. I'm so quickly getting a small glass of brandy.
You can forget the brandy, sir, and attend me if you please. Are I responsible for this young woman? Let go of those horses immediately.
Hey, stop that woman. Those are my horses, Docs, and it's my cab she's crashed back there. And if the young woman goes and excites them, there'll be murder here. Not by me, see, but by the horses. They can be downright feisty. Now steady, Starbury, steady, old boy.
You heard the man. Let off his horses.
You're a lady. You know all these people come after you, do you? You ought to go home. Lie down. Have a nice cup of tea, quiet life, and you'll feel ever so much better. Now steady, Starbury, steady, old boy.
Unhand your royal charger. I am Janus. Oh, what empress are you? We'll see about that.
Diggory!
Polly, I'm glad you're here.
We have to stop her. We have to take her away from here.
I've got the ring. If I can just get close enough to touch her.
Do you taunt me? Do you taunt me? Calm down, young woman. What are you doing? Let go of that post. Broken the lamp post off with her bare hands. All she's used, taunt me.
Diggory, she'll beat them to death.
Hold on to me tight. You'll have to manage the ring. And don't put it on until I shout.
Madam, my dear young lady, compose yourself.
Easy, Sharma, easy. Now come here.
Scums, you shall pay dearly for this when I come to your world. But one stone of your city will be left. I shall make it as charmed as Melinda and Starlords and Vermontin.
I've got her arm. Polly, the ring. Put on the ring.
Oh, is this delirium? Is this the end? Oh, I can't bear it. It's not fair. I never meant to be a magician. It's all misunderstanding. It's all my godmother's fault. Oh, I must protest against this in my state of health.
Oh, bother, Uncle Andrew. What are you doing here? You weren't supposed to come along. Are you there, Polly?
Yes, I'm here, but do stop shoving.
I'm not.
Oh no, we brought the horses too!
And the cabbie!
That's all right, Starbury. Ethel, now take it easy.
And the witch is still holding the iron bar.
Don't worry. See, she's as helpless as a baby.
What has happened?
That's all right, Starbury. Ethel, now come over to this pool and have a drink if that's what you want.
Are they still touching?
Yes.
Then let's ready the green ring.
Oh dear, what now?
Shouldn't we be there by now?
Well, we seem to be somewhere. I'm standing on something solid.
Now that you mention it, so am I. Why is it so dark? Do you think we got to the wrong pool?
Perhaps this is Charn, but we've arrived in the middle of the night.
This is not Charn, you fool. This is an empty world. This is nothing.
It's the strangest thing. Makes no difference whether my eyes are opened or closed.
And it's awfully cold.
My doom has come upon me.
My dear, please don't say such things. It can't be as bad as that.
Now then. Kiku, everyone. That's what I say. No bones broken, anyone? No? Good. That's something to be grateful for then, eh? More than anyone could expect her for falling all that way. Diggins, for a new underground is what I say. Right under the street. So someone will come and get us out presently. You'll see.
What are you on about?
Well, we must have fallen through a hole in the road. Unless we are dead. Which they don't deny is a possibility. Worst things happen at sea. And a chap's gotta happen sometime. And there ain't nothing to be afraid of as long as a chap's led a decent life. The only thing is, my sweet Helen and little Ruthie.
Diggory, slip on your ring. Let's leave these lunatics behind.
Fool! Do you not know that I can hear men's thoughts? Step away from that boy! If you attempt treachery, I shall set such vengeance upon you as was never heard of in all the world since the beginning!
And if you think I'm such a mean pig to go off and leave Polly and the horses in the cabin in a place like this, you're jolly well mistaken!
You are a very naughty and impertinent little boy.
Hush! Something's happening. Ah, listen to that. Ain't it lovely?
Then two wonders happened at the same moment. One was that a heavenly, cold, tingling, savory sound began. Everything became a bit different. The second wonder was that the blackness overhead was suddenly bright with stars and auroras.
The sky! Diggory, look at the sky!
I see.
Ah, glory be. I'd been a better man all my days hadn't I known there were things such as this.
Oh, where are the stars going? They're fading away.
I don't like this. I don't like it at all.
I say, I can see your face now.
And I can see yours.
Look, there's a light on the horizon beyond those hills. It's so lovely.
I don't like this. I don't like it at all.
I want the singing to stop. I want it to stop now.
The sun.
It seems like such a young sun.
Do you see? We're in a valley. And what a beautiful river.
But where's the trees and the bushes? Where's all the grass?
We need them. These colors are dazzling. Wait, what's that? Over there.
It's an animal, I think.
It's not just an animal. It's a lion.
It is indeed. And it's the one making the noise.
This is a terrible world. We must flee at once. Prepare the magic.
By degree, the matter, the most disagreeable place, completely uncivilized. If only you had a gun, I could shoot.
You don't think you can shoot him,
and
you?
And who would?
Prepare the magic, old fool.
Settle, madam. Children, slip on your horn rings at once, dearies.
Oh, it's rings, is it?
Stay away. If either one of you come a half an inch nearer, we two will vanish, and you'll be left here for good. Just keep your distance.
Hold your noises, everyone. Something's changed. You want grass, young man? There's your grass.
It's growing so fast.
So is the sky and the trees.
Give me the ring, boy. I want that ring.
Ha! You tried for the wrong pocket.
Give it to me.
Stop it, you fool. If you go within 10 paces of either child, I will lose this iron to knock out your brains. How dare you think of stealing back to your own world without me?
I was perfect within my rights. I have been most shamefully and abominably treated. I have done my best to show you such civilities as are in my power, and what is my reward? You have robbed highly respected jeweler. You insist on entertaining you to an exceedingly expensive, and not to say ostentatious, lunch. You've insulted the police. I feel as though I've been publicly disgraced.
Oh, stow it, Governor. Why didn't you listen? I'm not talking.
There was certainly plenty to watch and to listen to. Full-grown trees with branches swayed gently. We stood on cool green grass sprinkled with daisies and buttercups. A little way off the riverbank, willows were growing. On the other side, Tangles of flowering wild roses and rhododendrons and morning glories closed them in. All this time, the lion's song was going on to and fro, backwards and forwards. With each turn, he came a little nearer.
There's a connection, don't you see, between his song and the things that are happening. He made those deep, long notes happen, and those dark flowers appeared on the ridge. He made those lighter notes, and those primroses shot up. He's creating it all with his song.
That's ridiculous. Lions don't sing. We're seeing things.
He's coming closer.
Not back my way.
No!
Oh, did he see that? It hit him right between the eyes.
And he didn't even notice.
No!
What should we do? Should we run with the queen?
An excellent idea. As soon as my knees stop shaking, I will.
Wait, don't move. He's coming closer. Oh, he's not looking at us.
Why do you suppose he won't look at us?
I wish he would.
All right. Now that we've got rid of that woman and the brute of a lion is gone, give me your hand and slip on your ring at once.
Stay away! Keep clear of him, Polly. Come over here, beside me. I warn you, Uncle Andrew, don't come one step nearer or we'll vanish.
Do what we're told this minute. You're an extremely disobedient and ill-behaved boy.
No fear. We want to stay and see what happens.
Or don't we, Polly? I thought you wanted to learn about other worlds. Don't you like it now that you're here?
Like it? Just look at the state I'm in. Perhaps if I was a younger man, I'd find this a more interesting place, but I'm too old. Oh, only I had a gun.
Oh, younger me blasted. I think I'll go give Strawberry and Apple a good penny. They got more sense than some humans, I can mention. Strawberry, Apple.
I don't really think that lion could be killed by a gun anyways. It didn't seem to mind getting hit by the iron bar much.
Yes, it didn't stop him or... Hello? What's that? There, where the iron bar hit the ground.
It's... Why, it's a lamppost. It's growing like a tree.
Remarkable, most remarkable. We're in a world where everything comes alive and grows. Drop a crossbar here and it grows into a lamppost. This is stupendous. Just think of the commercial possibilities. Bring a few scraps of iron here, bury them, and they'll come up as new engines, railways, battleships, anything you please. It costs nothing. You can sell for full price back in England. I shall be a millionaire. First things, get that lion shot.
You're just like the witch. All you think of is killing things.
And as for myself, who knows how long I live if I settled here. I wouldn't be surprised if I never grew a day older in this country, the land of youth.
Oh, the land of youth? Do you think it really is? Do you think there's something here that could cure Mother?
What are you talking about? This isn't a pharmacist's job.
You don't care tuppence about her. I thought you might, since she's your sister as well as my mother. Well, it doesn't matter anyways. I'm jolly well going to ask Lion himself if he can help me.
Diggory, where are you going?
To find the lion.
Are you mad? Come back here, boy. Come back.
Diggory came to the edge of the wood, and there he stopped. The lion was still making music, but now the song had once more changed. The cabbie stayed with Diggory and Polly, watching the scene before them. Its presence was fully commanding and enthralling. The lion's music grew louder and then stopped.
Narnia, 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 awake. Love, think, speak. Be walking trees, be talking beasts, be divine waters.
And as if they were waking from a long sleep, the creatures stirred and moved. There were groups here and there, but closer to Aslan, there were some truly magnificent ones.
Well, strike me pink. I always did say those horses had a lot of sense, though.
Creatures, I give you yourselves. I give you forever this land
of Narnia. I give you its woods, its fruits, its waters, its stars, and I give you myself. The lesser beasts, which I have not chosen for speech, are yours also. Treat them gently and cherish them, but do not return to their ways, lest you cease be talking beasts. For from them you are taken, and into them you can return. Do not so.
We won't.
No fear, Aslan.
Go on, laugh, and fear not. Creatures, now that you are no longer dumb and witless, you need not be so grave. For humor, as well as justice, come with speech.
Aslan, did I make the first joke? Will everybody always be told how I made the first joke?
No, little friend. You have not made the first joke. You have only been the first joke. And now, Narnia is established. We must take great care in keeping it safe. For though the land is not yet 5 hours old, an evil has already entered.
What did he say had entered the world?
A Neevil.
What's a Neevil?
No, he didn't say Neevil. He said Weevil.
Well, what's that?
Look here, Polly. I've got to go after him. Aslan, the lion.
Do you think we can? I wouldn't dare.
I have to. It's about my mother. See, if anyone could give me something that would do her good, it would be him.
And I'll come along with Diggory. I like the look of Aslan, and I want a word with old Strawberry and Ethel.
What in the name of Aslan is he?
Please.
There's some kind of large lettuce. That's my belief.
No, we're not. Honestly, we're not. We're not at all nice to eat.
They can talk? We haven't heard of talking leaves. Perhaps they're the second joke.
Oh, please. I'm in a hurry. I want to see the lion.
Here, let me try. Now, Strawberry, you know me. And you ain't gonna stand there and say you don't know me.
Well, I don't exactly know. Most of us don't know much about anything yet. But of certain idea, I've seen a thing like this before. I'm feeling I lived somewhere else, or was something else, before Aslan woke us all up a few minutes ago.
Me too, Strawberry. It's all very muddled like a dream. But these three were in the dream.
What? Not know me? Me who used to bring you hot mash of oats when you're out of sorts? Me who've never forgot to put a blanket on your back if you were cold? Never would have thought it of you, Strawberry. Ethel?
Well, it does begin to come back. Yes, you used to tie that horrid black thing behind us and hit us to make us run. And however far you ran, this black thing would always be coming behind us.
Why, we had our living to earn, see? You're the same as mine. Had there been no cab, no whip, there would have been no stable, and no hay, and no oats. And you got a taste of sugar, and that's something no one can deny.
I remember that, but I also remember always running in front, pulling you and the black thing. I did all the work. It's hard.
Well, too true, mate. I didn't like it any more than you did. You were country horses, and I was a country man.
Oh, please, please, can we get on? The lion's getting further and further away, and I do so want to speak to him.
Look here, Strawberry. This young gentleman has something on his mind he'd like to talk to the lion about. Him as you call Aslan. Now, suppose you were to lay him right on your back, and you trot over the lion, eh? And then me and the little girl and Ethel could follow along.
Right. Oh, I remember now, yeah. Oh, please, Strawberry, do let me get up and take me to Aslan. Well, I don't mind. Not for once in a while. Come on, up you get.
Good old Strawberry. Here we go, Diggory.
Thank you, Strawberry. Mr. Lion, Mr. Aslan, sir, please will you give me some magic fruit of this country to make my mother well?
You are the boy who did it.
Oh dear, what have I done now?
Son of Adam, there is an evil witch abroad in my new land of Narnia. Tell me how she came to be here.
I brought her here, Aslan. I wanted to get her out of my own world, back into hers. I thought I was taking her back to her own place.
How came she to be in your world, son of Adam?
By magic. It was my uncle, you see. He sent us out of our world by magic rings. At least, I had to go because he sent Polly first. And we met the witch in a place called Charm. And she held on to us, and...
You met the witch?
She woke up. I mean, I woke her.
because I wanted to know what would happen if I struck the bell. Polly didn't want to. It wasn't her fault. I fought her. I know I shouldn't have. I think I was enchanted by the writing under the bell.
Do you?
Well, I see now that I wasn't. I was only pretending.
Before the new, clean world I gave them was 5 hours old, and evil has already entered, woke and brought hither by this son of Adam. Evil will come of that evil, but it is still a long ways off, and I will be sure that the worst falls upon myself. In the meantime, let us take such order, so for that several hundred years yet, this will be a merry land and a merry world. And as Adam's race has done harm, Adam's race shall help to heal it. Draw near, you other two.
Us?
Yes.
Oh dear, yes sir?
Son, I have known you long. Do you know me?
Well, no sir, leastways not in ordinary manner of speaking. Yet, if I may speak so free, I feels as if we've met before.
It is well. You know me better than you think you know, and you will live to know me better yet. How does this land please you?
It's a fair treat, sir.
Would you like to live here always?
Well, you see, sir, I'm a married man, a family man. Now my wife and daughter were here, none of us would ever want to go back to London, I reckon. We're all country folks. Really, you see, I mean, what do you want me?
Children, you are to be the first king and queen of Narnia. You will name these creatures and do justice among them, and protect them when enemies arise. And enemies will arise, for there is an evil witch in the world.
Frank!
Thank you, sir, but I don't think we're fit for that sort of job.
Will you rule these creatures kindly and fairly, remembering that they are not slaves like the dumb beasts in your world, but talking thinking beasts and free subjects?
Sir, I try, and I do the square thing by them all.
And if enemies came to the land and there was war, would you be the first in the charge and the last in retreat?
Well, sir, a man doesn't exactly know till he's been tried. But I'd try. That is, I'd hope I'd try. I'd do my part.
Then you all have done all that a king should do. There will be a coronation eventually, and you and your children and your grandchildren will be blessed. And some will be kings of Narnia, and others will be kings of Arkenland, which lies yonder over the southern mountains. And you, little daughter, are welcome. Good child, have you forgiven the boy for the violence he has done to you in the accursed palace of Charn?
Yes, Aslan, we've made up.
It is well, and now for the boy himself. My son, are you ready to undo the wrong you have done to my sweet country of Narnia on the very day of its birth?
Yes, sir, but I don't see what I can do. You see, the queen ran away and...
I asked, are you ready?
Yes, but please, please could you give me something that could cure my mother?
Up until then, Digory had been looking at the lion's great front feet. Now, in his despair, he looked up at his face. What he saw surprised him just as much as anything in his whole life, for the great face was bent down near his own, and wonder of wonders, tears stood in the lion's eyes. They were such full tears, and for a moment, he felt that the lion may be sorrier about his mother than he was himself.
My son, I know. Grief is great. Only you and I, in this land, know that yet. Let us be good to one another. But I have to think of hundreds of years in the life of Narnia. The witch, whom you have brought to this world, will return to this world once again. But it need not be yet. It is my wish to plant a tree in Narnia, a tree that she will not dare to approach, a tree that will protect Narnia from her for many years, so the land will have a long, bright morning before the clouds come over the sun. My son, I will tell you what you must do. Look west. Now the land of Narnia ends, where the waterfall comes down. And when you reach the top of those high cliffs, you will be out of Narnia. Eventually, you will come to a green valley with a blue lake in it. At the end of the lake, there is a steep green hill. At the top of the hill, there is a garden. In the middle of the garden, there is a tree.
pluck an apple from that tree and bring it back to me.
Yes, Aslan, but I hope you're not in a hurry. I mean, I shan't be able to get there and back very quickly.
My son, you still have help. Come here, horse.
I'm your servant, Aslan.
Would you like to be a winged horse?
Oh, if you wish, Aslan. If you really meant it. Well, I don't know why you should be me. I'm not a very clever horse.
Be winged. Be the father of all flying horses. From now on, your name is Fledge.
Whoa, that's amazing! Whoa. Whoa.
Will you carry this little son of Adam on your back to the valley I spoke of?
I shall, Aslan!
What are the two daughters of Eve whispering about?
Sorry. If you please, sir, I think the little girl would love to go too, if it weren't no trouble.
Fledge, being the small horse, shan't be able to carry both.
I say I'm right here, Aslan.
Well then, horse, be winged.
Whoa.
Oh my goodness.
What? And no brand name?
No.
Up you go.
Majesty.
And now, be gone with my blessing.
The animals and creatures still in the clearing had noticed Uncle Andrew and turned their attention to him. Now, Uncle Andrew had really disliked the music that the lion had made and generally disliked the whole world. He had convinced himself that he was really at home in his attic and had fallen into a deep sleep and a terrible dream. Now, the trouble about trying to make yourself stupider than you really are is that you very often succeed. He now only heard growling and snarling when the creatures spoke.
Yes, don't let him escape.
We've caught the Nephew!
Hurrah!
Well done, us.
Now, sir, are you an animal, vegetable, or mineral?
Now, you may think the animals are very stupid not to see at once that Uncle Andrew is the same kind of creature as the two children in the cabbie. But you must remember, they knew little of anything, having just been created, thought that Dickory's coat and Polly's frock and the cabbie's hat were just as much a part of them as their own fur and feathers. Uncle Andrew was also a great deal taller than the children and dressed much finer than the cabbie, and his great mop of hair was unlike anything they had seen in the other humans. He also didn't seem to be able to talk, so they were puzzled.
There, it's only a tree.
It's an animal, certainly an animal.
An animal that just claps like that?
Yes, we're animals and we don't do that.
I have certain ideas trying to speak before it toppled over.
It was just the wind in its branches. Perhaps it's an animal that can't speak, but thinks it can.
It's not an animal at all. It's not alive.
It is an animal, just smell it.
A nose isn't everything.
Why, if a fellow can't trust his nose, who is he to trust?
His brain, perhaps?
He's not a tree. He's not an animal. I would say he's some kind of mix-up, but I know Aslan doesn't make mistakes.
Well,
Well, perhaps he's dangerous, so let's tie him up and bring him to Aslan, Dilkim. Oh, Fledge, this is fun. Hold on tight, Polly.
Look at the mountains. I say, look behind us.
The entire Valley of Narnia.
Oh, it's cold up here.
My wings are starting to ache. There's no sign of a valley with a lake in it, like Aslan said.
How about going down and look for more decent places to spend the night at?
They found a little meadow and landed. The children lay down on either side of the horses, who spread their wings over them, and they were quite snug. As the stars of the new world came out, they talked over everything. At one point, they thought they heard something in the wood and got up to look for the source of the noise. Finding nothing, they lay down again and were soon asleep. The next morning, the sun came over the hill and the children got on Fledge's and Ethel's backs and the second journey began. It was a wonderful ride. Big snowy mountains rose above them in every direction. The valleys below them were so green, and the streams that tumbled down beneath them were so blue, it was like flying over gigantic pieces of jewelry. Quite soon, they were sniffing the air for the most heavenly smell, warm and golden, as if from all the most delicious fruits and flowers of the world was coming up to them from somewhere ahead. There was a blue lake with a hill at the end. The horses landed beside the garden that sat on the hill.
By the golden gates, or not at all. Take of my fruits for others, or forbear. For those who steal, and those who climb my wall, shall find their heart's desire, or find despair. What do you think it means? Who'd want to climb a wall when they can get in by a gate?
If one can get the gates open.
This is obviously a very frightening. I think only those invited should go in.
Let's wait over there then.
All right, but how am I to open the gates?
Perhaps you should simply try.
I say, well done, Polly.
Now that he could see into the place, it looked more private than ever. He went in very solemnly, looking about him. Everything was very quiet inside. The lovely smell rose all about him. It was a happy place, but very serious. He knew which was the right tree at once, because the great silver apples with which it was loaded shone so and cast a light of their own down on the shadowy places where the sunlight could not reach. He walked straight to it, picked an apple, and put it in the pocket of his jacket, but he couldn't help looking at it and smelling it before he put it away.
It smells delicious. I wonder if it would be wrong to taste one.
After a moment, Digory decided not to eat one of the apples. Things like "do not steal" were hammered into boys' heads, I think, a good deal harder in those days than they are now. Digory was just turning to go back to the gates when he got a terrible shock.
Go on, boy! Eat one!
It was the witch. She was throwing away the core of an apple which she had just eaten. Digory guessed at once that she must have climbed over the wall, and he began to see there may be some sense in that last line of getting your heart's desire and getting despair along with it. For the witch looked stronger and prouder than ever, and even in a way triumphant. But her eyes, crueler than ever.
Quick, Polly, get on Ethel! Polly, Ethel!
That's right, child.
Stay away! We still have the rings! Don't come an inch near or we'll vanish!
Foolish boy! Why do you run from me? I mean you no harm. If you do not stop and listen to me now, you will miss some knowledge that could have made you happy all your life.
Well, I don't want to hear it, thanks.
I know what errand you've come on. For it was I who was close beside you in the woods last night. I've heard all your counsels. You've plucked a fruit from the garden yonder. You have it in your pocket now, and you're going to take it back, untasted, to the lion, for him to eat, for him to use. You simpleton, do you not know what that fruit is? It is the apple of life, the apple of youth. I know, for I've tasted it, and I already feel such changes in myself that I shall never grow old or die. Eat, boy, eat it. And you and I shall live forever and be king and queen of this whole world.
or of your world if you choose to go back there.
No thanks. I don't care that much about living on and on after everyone I know is dead. I'd rather live an ordinary time and die and go to heaven.
Good for you, Diggory.
But what about this mother of yours, whom you pretend to love so?
What has she got to do about it?
Do you not see, fool, that one bite of that apple would heal her? You have it in your pocket now. We are here by ourselves, and the line is far away. Use your magic and go back to your own world. In 1 minute, you can be at your mother's side to give her the fruit. Soon, she will tell you she feels stronger. Then she will fall asleep. Hours of sweet, natural sleep without pain. Next day, everyone will be saying how wonderfully she has recovered. Soon, she will be quite well again. All will be well again. Your home will be happy again. You will be like other boys. What has the lion ever done for you that you should be his slave? What would your mother think if she knew that you could have taken away her pain, given her back her life, but that you wouldn't? You'd rather an errand to some wild animal that is no business of yours.
But I don't think he's a wild animal. He is...
Then he is something worse. Look what he's done to already. Look how heartless he has made you. That is what he does to everyone who listens to him. Cruel, pitiless boy. You will let your own mother die rather than...
Oh, shut up. But don't you see? I promised.
Ah, but you didn't know what you're promising, did you? Then no one here can prevent you. Then no one home would know. You need to take the little girl back with you, you know.
What?
You could go without her. No one in your world would be the wiser.
You very nearly had me there.
What do you mean?
All that nonsense you were saying about my mother, you almost had me convinced. But suggesting I should leave Polly behind suddenly reminded me of who and what you are.
Good for you, Diggory. Let's get away, now.
Right.
No, wait! No! Go then, fools! Think of me far when you lay old and dying. And remember how you threw away the chance of endless youth. To all to be offered you again!
So it is, son of Adam.
I've brought you the apple you wanted, sir.
Well done, well done. For this fruit you have hungered and thirsted and wept. No hands but yours shall sow the seed that is to be the protection of Narnia. Throw the apple there. It is well thrown. Now let us proceed to the coronation of King Frank and Helen, his queen.
King Frank and Queen Helen and Princess Ruth were dressed in elegant and beautiful clothes, and rich robes flowed out behind them. Their heads were bare, but Helen had let her hair down, and it made a great improvement in her appearance. Yet, it was neither clothes nor hair that made them look so different from their old selves. Their faces had no expression, especially the king's. All the sharpness and quarreling that he had picked up as a cabbie seemed to have been washed away, and the courage and kindness we had always had were easier to see.
Upon my word, Miss Polly, now the master's been changing nearly as much as I have. Why, he's a real master now.
Yes, he is.
Uncle Andrew!
Yes, yes, it is I.
What's happened to you?
Those stupid beasts tied me up.
But why didn't you simply tell them that...
Tell them? Try talking to these animals, fool. They're terrible brutes.
Bring out that creature.
I'll talk to Aslan for you, if you like.
Talk to Aslan? You are mad. Just leave me be.
Aslan, please, could you say something to unfrighten him? And then you could say something to prevent him from ever coming back again.
Do you think he wants to?
Well, he might send someone else. He's so excited about the bar of a lamppost growing into a lamppost tree. And he thinks...
He thinks great folly, child. This world is bursting with life for these few days because the song of which I call it into life still hangs in the air and rumbles in the ground. It will not be so for long. But I cannot tell that to this old sinner, and I cannot comfort him either, for he has made himself unable to hear my voice. If I spoke to him, he would hear only growlings and rumblings. Oh, sons of Adam, how well you protect yourself against all that might do you good. But I can give him the only gift he's able to receive. Sleep. Sleep and be separated for some few hours from all the torments you have devised upon yourself.
I've had an idea. Sleep, that's a marvelous idea.
Bear, take him aside and lay him down. And Fawn, bring me the crown.
Rise up, King, Queen of Narnia, Father, Mother of many kings that shall be, kings that shall rule over Narnia. And rise up, Queen Ruth of Arkhamland, be just and merciful and brave. The blessing is upon you.
And now, look.
All turned to see what Aslan spoke of. They saw a tree which had certainly not been there before. Must have grown up silently, yet swiftly, while they were all busy about the coronation. Its spreading branches seemed to cast a light rather than a shade, and silver apples peeped out like stars.
Son, you have sown well, and you, Narnians, let it be your first care to guard this tree, for it is your shield. The witch, whom I have told you of, has fled far away into the north of the world. She will live on there, growing stronger in dark magic. But as this tree flourishes, she will not come down into Narnia. She dare not come within 100 miles of this tree, for its smell, which is joy and life and health to you, is death and horror and despair to her.
Aslan, I forgot to tell you. The witch has already eaten one of those apples. One of the same ones that tree has grown from.
So there must be some mistake. She can't really mind the smell of those apples.
Why do you think that, daughter of Eve?
Well, she ate one.
Child, that is why all the rest are now a whore to her. That is what happens to those who pluck and eat the fruits at the wrong time and in the wrong way. All the fruit is good. They loathe it after. She has won her heart's desire. She has unwearying strength and endless days like a goddess. But length of days with an evil heart is length of misery, and she already begins to know it.
I almost ate one myself, Aslan. Would I have?
Yes, you would, for the fruit always works. It must work, but it does not work happily for any who pluck it at their own will. If any Narnian, unbidden, had stolen an apple to protect Narnia, it would have protected Narnia, but it would have done so by making it into another strong, cruel empire, like Charm, not the kindly land I meant it to be. And the witch tempted you to do another thing, my son, did she not?
Yes, she wanted me to take an apple back to my mother.
Understand then that it would have healed her, but not to your joy or hers. The day would come when both you and she would look back and say, it would have been better to die in that illness.
But Aslan, what am I to do about my mother?
That is what would have happened with the stolen apple. That is not what will happen now. What I bring you will bring joy. Go. It will not in your world bring endless youth, but it will heal. Go. Pluck her an apple from the tree.
Thank you, Aslan. Now, may we go home? We still have the rings.
You need no rings when I am with you. Time, you must go home. But look here, but there are two things to see to first, a warning and a command. Look here, children. See that hollow? It was once a pool. When you jumped into it, you came to a land where a dying sun shone over the ruins of Charn. There is no pool now. That world is ended as if it had never began. Let the race of Adam and Eve take warning.
But we're not quite as bad as that world, are we?
Not yet, Polly, but you are growing more like it. And it is not certain that some wicked one of your race will find out a secret as evil as the deplorable word and use it to destroy all living things. And soon, very soon, before you are an old man and an old woman, your world will be ruled by tyrants who care no more for joy and justice and mercy than the Empress Jadis. Let your world beware. That was the warning, and now for the command. As soon as you can, take from that uncle of yours his magic rings and bury them so that no one may use them again.
Both the children were looking into the lion's face as he spoke these words, and all at once they felt his sweetness and power all around them. And they felt that they had never really been happy or wise or good or even alive and awake before standing with him just then. The memory of that moment stayed with them always.
Has taken no time at all.
Now, where is the young woman who caused all this disorder?
What? What's happened? Oh, I'm so confused.
You had something to do with this, didn't you?
He's in a state, Constable.
And he lives right here. May we take him in?
Well, I suppose, but I want a formal statement later.
Come on, Uncle Andrew, inside.
I need brandy. Oh, now let go of me. I shall go have a bath. But first, tell Matilda to bring me brandy.
Yes, sir. Polly, can you take the rings? I want to go to Mother.
Right.
Apple.
You will eat it, won't you?
I don't know what the doctor would say, but really, I almost feel as if I could.
Then do.
This must be the most delicious apple I've ever tasted.
Eat all of it, please, Mother. Sleep well, Mother.
He stole out of the room with a beating heart, taking the core of the apple with him. He hardly dared to hope what would happen, but when he remembered the face of Aslan, he did hope. That evening, he buried the core of the apple in the back garden.
One day she's holding Dad's hand, and the next day she's got her color and strength back. I don't want to raise any false hopes, but he does say it's a miracle.
What luck? I mean, about your mother.
I rather think so, too. But I'd rather not talk about it now. Do you have the rings?
I've got them all here. Gloves on?
Gloves on.
Let's bury them. Diggory, was this tree here before? I don't remember it.
No, it's where I buried the apple core.
Oh, how lovely. Is that why you've dug that circle around it?
Yes. It seemed rather right to bury the rings around the tree. Goodbye, rings.
About a week after this, it was quite certain that Diggory's mother was getting quite better. Within 2 weeks, she was able to sit out in the garden, and a month later, the whole house had become a different place. Aunt Letty did everything that Mother liked. Windows were opened, frowsy curtains were drawn back to brighten up the rooms. There were new flowers everywhere, and nicer things to eat. And they all had such games with Diggory and Polly that Aunt Letty would say that Diggory's mother was the biggest child of the three. How joyous it was. India with the news that his old great-uncle Kirk had died and left them a mansion as an inheritance. This meant that he could retire and come home from India forever and ever, and their great house in the country had suits of armor and stables and kennels and a river and a park, vineyard and a wood and woods, and even mountains behind it. Polly came to the house in the summers where she learned to ride and swim and bake and climb. Uncle Andrew, who learned his lesson and never tried any magic again, came to live with them there. In his old age, he became a nicer and less selfish man than he'd ever been before, and he never tried any magic again as long as he lived. In Narnia, all lived in great peace and joy for hundreds of years. King Frank and Queen Helen and their children ruled happily in there. And so, Diggory felt just as sure as you are that they are going to live happily ever after. But perhaps you would like to know just a few things more. The lamppost that the witch had planted, without knowing, shone day and night in the Narnian forest, so that the place where it grew came to be called Lantern Waste. The tree, which sprang forth from the apple that Diggory had planted in the back garden, lived and grew into a fine tree, growing in the soil of our world, far out of the sound of Aslan's voice and far from the fresh air of Narnia. It did not bear apples that would revive a dying woman, although it did bear apples that were more beautiful than any apples in England. And they're extremely good for you, though not fully magical. But inside the tree itself, in the very sap of it, the tree never forgot that other tree in Narnia to which it belonged. It was proved later when there was still magic in its wood, for when Diggory was quite middle-aged and had become a great traveler and professor, he revisited the Ketterleys' home, and there was a great storm all over the south of England which blew the tree down. He couldn't bear to simply have it chopped up for firewood, so he had part of the timber made into a wardrobe, which he put in his big house in the country. And though he himself did not discover the magical properties of the wardrobe, someone else did. That was the beginning of all the comings and goings between Narnia and our world. But that is a story for another time.